Now, let's move to the second part, which is about the Advantage Actor-Critic method, abbreviated as A2C. Why is it called A2C? Because there are two A's here. A2C is essentially an extension of QAC, and its core idea is to introduce a new baseline or called bias term to reduce the variance in estimation. First of all, let's check an interesting property. The policy gradient that we derived earlier is invariant to an additional baseline. This is the gradient we derived previously. If we subtract a new baseline denoted as B from the Q value Q pi, this does not change the gradient. Here, this baseline B is a function of the state, and it's a scalar function. These two equations are equivalent. No matter what the function B is, the result will be the same. Now, we need to answer two questions. First, why is it valid? That is why introducing a new B does not affect the gradient. Second, why is it useful? That is why we need to care about the function B. What is its purpose in introducing it? Let's answer the first question. Why is this true? We return to the previous slide where these two equations are valid. Clearly, multiplying this term by the baseline B and then taking the expectation should give us zero. So, this equation must hold. Next, I will explain why it is valid. Let's go through it. And it's actually quite simple. If we move this term to the left, we get this expression. Now, expanding the expectation according to its definition, we first sum over the states S, with the distribution for each state S being the one shown here. Then, we sum over the actions A, with their corresponding distribution as shown here. This matches what we have in the brackets, so we can move it here. Now, we can combine the two terms together. When we take the gradient of the logarithm of pi, this is essentially the gradient of pi divided by pi. The two pi's cancel each other out, leaving the gradient of pi. The baseline bs can be factored out front, because bs is only a function of s and it has no relationship with a. This allows us to move it to the front as a common factor. Hypothetically, if the baseline B were a function of A, we couldn't move it to the front, and introducing the baseline would change the expectation. So, the key point here is that B must only be a function of S, and it must not depend on A. Furthermore, we can take the gradient outside the summation. For state S, we sum over all possible actions A, and the probability distribution for the action sums to 1. Therefore, when we take the gradient of 1, since the derivative of any constant is 0, we know this results in 0. Therefore, the equation is valid. This explains why introducing a new baseline function b does not change the gradient. Now, let's answer the second question. Why do we need to consider this baseline and what is its purpose? First, this is the gradient we derived earlier, which equals an expectation. We can write the entire expression inside the brackets as a new variable, x. We already know that this ex is invariant to the baseline bs. That is, the expectation of x remains unchanged no matter what b is. However, the variance of x, denoted as var, is influenced by b. Different choices for b can lead to different variances. Why is that the case? Let's take a look. If x is a scalar, the variance is straightforward. If x is a vector, the variance becomes a matrix. We usually use the trace of this matrix, which is the sum of the diagonal elements, to evaluate the magnitude of the variance. It is equal to E of x transpose x minus x bar, transpose x bar, and x bar is Ex. Why is this valid? There's a simple derivation for this, which you can find in my book, so I won't go into the details here. This value remains constant, regardless of what Bs is. However, this value can be affected by the choice of baseline. Why? We can calculate the value and the result is as follows. This is the gradient of the log pi and then we take the norm and square it. The expression inside the brackets is q minus the baseline and then we square the difference. We can imagine that if b is equal to 0 or a very large number, say 1 billion, the effect on the variance will be quite different. The entire derivation can be found in my book, but the key message here is that the baseline does affect the variance. Since the baseline affects the variance, our goal is to select an optimal baseline B to minimize the variance X. Why do we want to minimize the variance? Because when we perform sampling, we want to reduce the error as much as possible. Let's look at an example. Suppose there is a random variable that is sampled at different times, and the characteristic of this random variable is as follows. Its expected value corresponds to this specific line, and its variance is very small. Now let's consider another random variable. Its expected value is also the same line, but its variance is much larger. Clearly, if we sample the random variable with a small variance, each sample will be very close to its expected value EX. So the sampled value will be very close to the EX. However, if the variance is large, the sample could differ greatly from EX. Thus, we want the variance of X to be as small as possible. In the earlier algorithms like reinforce and QAC, there is no baseline. Mathematically, this means that the baseline B is equal to zero, which may not be a very good baseline. What is a good or the best baseline? It is given by this expression, meaning that for any state S, the optimal baseline should be equal to this. With this baseline, the variance of the resulting X will be minimized. Let's look at this expression. It is a little complex with expectations in both the numerator and the denominator. The blue part represents a weight, which involves taking the gradient of log pi, then computing the norm and squaring it. The red part corresponds to the action value QSA. The specific details of how to obtain this can be found in my book. Please pay attention. Although this baseline is optimal, it's too complex. What we often do is to simplify it by removing the weight and directly calculating the expectation of Q. What is this? Isn't it obvious that it is V pi S? That is, it's the state value of S. So, even though this is optimal, we don't use it. Instead, we use this simple one. In some literature, you might see the authors say that this is optimal, but in fact, this is not optimal. It's just that we often use it. Just now, I introduced some basic properties of the baseline. Now let's see how to introduce the baseline into the Actor-Critic algorithm and what interesting conclusions we can draw from it. Actually, it's quite simple. I set this baseline as V pi S, which is the state value. This is the corresponding gradient ascent algorithm. Here I write Q pi minus V pi as a new function denoted as delta pi. This delta pi is called the advantage function. Sometimes it is denoted as A, but since I've already used A to represent actions, I use delta here instead. Why is it called the advantage function? It describes the difference between Q pi and V pi, or the advantage of Q pi over V pi. What is V pi? I'm not sure if you still remember. When we introduced the concept of action value, I mentioned that a state's value equals the average of all the action values associated with that state. Now, if an action's value is greater than this average, it means that the action is better than the average. Therefore, it has some advantages. This is why it's called the advantage function. There's an expectation, and we naturally want to get its stochastic version. This is the resulting stochastic algorithm. Now let's put this algorithm here. We can reorganize it a bit. Actually, we did something similar in the last lecture. That is, here is log pi and its gradient. I wrote it as the gradient of pi divided by pi. Then we can combine these two as a fraction. When we move this to the right, we get the following equation. In this equation, the numerator inside the brackets is delta, which is the advantage function, and the denominator is pi. In the last lecture, we mentioned that the policy gradient method can effectively balance exploration and exploitation with this. We can briefly review this again. When delta t is large, the step size is also larger. A larger step size means that the algorithm will update pi ATST more significantly. As a result, the probability of selecting that action will increase in the next step. This means that the action that has a higher value at this moment would have a higher probability of being selected in the next step. This is exploitation. On the other hand, if the probability of the policy is small, the step size is also larger, and the probability of choosing that action in the next step will increase. This means that if the action's probability was small earlier, the algorithm will give it a higher probability of being selected. This is exploration. This balance between the numerator and denominator helps strike a good balance between exploration and exploitation. We explained this thoroughly in the last lecture. If it's unclear to you, you can revisit the previous lecture. In the last lecture, we worked with QT, but now it is delta t. Is QT or delta t better? Clearly, delta t is better. Why? Because we're not concerned with the absolute value of the action value. We care more about its relative value. For example, suppose an action value is 100 million, but the other action values for the same state are 200 million. In that case, I wouldn't consider this action as good. On the other hand, if an action value is 0, but other action values are negative 1, then 0 would be considered the better action. So we care about the relative value rather than the absolute value. Another important technique is about the advantage function. Earlier, we defined the advantage function delta as the difference between q and v. In this case, q pi and v pi have been replaced by qt and vt. Now we replace this with rt plus 1 plus gamma vtst plus 1 minus vtst. That is, qt is replaced with this term. What does this represent? This is essentially the td error. Why is this replacement reasonable? From an expectation perspective, if we take the expectation of q pi minus v pi, it is equivalent to the expectation of r plus gamma v pi s prime minus v pi s. The benefit of doing this is as follows. If we use this, we need one function or neural network to approximate q and another to approximate v. But now we only need a single neural network to approximate v, which simplifies the problem. This leads to the A2C algorithm, which is also known as the TD actor-critic method, as it uses the TD error to estimate the value function. Let's briefly go through the algorithm. At time step t, we have a policy pi AST theta t and use it to generate an action AT. After interacting with the environment, we obtain RT plus 1 and ST plus 1. From this, we calculate the TD error, which is the advantage function. We then substitute this TD error into the critic. The critic is responsible for updating the value function. This approach combines the TD algorithm with value function approximation, which we introduced earlier. Furthermore, the delta t can be reused by the actor. It can be used when we update the policy. This is the algorithm we just discussed. Once we obtain the results, we use them in the next cycle to gather new data. Therefore, this is an on-policy algorithm. Since the policy pi is stochastic here, we do not need to use techniques like epsilon greedy.